One of the most interesting things to consider about the Theosophical movement in general is the cultural impact about the movement itself. And of course, the movement is important within the context of the history of modern Western esotericism. That is fair enough. So it's part of, let's say, the small history of esotericism. But I think this is not the whole of the picture, because I think that the influence and the impact of Theosophy goes way beyond the strict limits of esotericism. So in fact, some time ago I published an essay, and this was published in a volume that was released on the occasion of the 10th anniversary of the Center for Hermetic Philosophy here at the University of Amsterdam. The title is Hermes in the Academy. So in this volume I published an essay titled The Modernity of Occultism, Reflections on Some Crucial Aspects. In fact, it is available on my academia.edu page, in case you're interested to read it. And in this essay I focused on what seemed to be the broader cultural aspects in the history of the Theosophical movement. Because probably the most interesting aspect about this impact is the fact that if you consider it on the whole, you can see that there is a kind of trend that is visible, and it's a kind of progressive trend. If you place the Theosophical movement back into the social and cultural context, especially in the early history, I am referring especially to, let's say, the last quarter of the 19th century and the first quarter of the 20th century, so roughly from 1875, the foundation of the society, up until the early years after the First World War, well, you realize that there is this kind of progressive trend that is very visible and very strong. And this reflects on different levels, of course, different levels of relation with society. So it has to do, for instance, with theosophical views on gender, the fact that you have women playing such a prominent role in the society, being also the leaders, the fact that there are very strong contacts also with feminism, with contemporary feminism at the time. There are interesting things to say about the views on the body and on sexuality. Also about the self, the fact that the early history of the Theosophical Society coincides with the early history of psychoanalysis also. Mm-hmm. And that in fact much of the activities that took place whenever the teachings of Theosophy were sort of translated into practice, even if, as I said, sometimes this created some tension. But when this happened, it's clear that what was going on was a kind of exploration of the self that led to really two interesting experiments with disintegration of the self, reconstruction of the self, that to some extent was also related to what was going on in contemporary psychology. Well, also important is to mention the views in the Theosophical movement about colonialism, imperialism, the fact that, of course, the Theosophical Society was very much in favor of Indian independence, Indian self-rule at the beginning, but then later also with some nuances also to Indian independence. And in fact, Annie Besant, the Theosophical leader, is even to this day considered as one of the major figures in Indian history, as leading to precisely to a kind of political thinking towards independence. And then finally also changing views about religion. So a very strong emphasis against dogmatism and against a strict Puritan and literal reading of the sacred texts of the Bible. So in this sense there is a clear progressive trend that is visible at least in the early history of the Theosophical movement. But perhaps the most interesting aspect in which Theosophy interacted with contemporary culture is the influence on art art understood in a broad sense, so the visual arts, but also the applied arts, architecture, and also, very importantly, music, and then also literature, of course. And it's not hard to find examples of authors who perhaps were not theosophists in the strict sense, but who were at least curious and interested in theosophical teachings. And you have it a little bit everywhere, in all parts of Europe. You have Adrian Klein in Spain, you have James Joyce in Great Britain, not to mention William Butler Yeats, who in this case was actually also a theosophist, Antonio Fogazzaro and Pirandello in Italy, even Franz Kafka in the German-speaking area. So, I mean, even in literature it's clear that it is an important phenomenon. But perhaps it is even a stronger phenomenon in the visual arts. And in fact, it is very interesting to consider that especially the second generation of theosophical leaders in the other branch of the Theosophical Movement were very keen on translating visually their teachings. And this was the case particularly with Charles Webster Leadbeater, who had this kind of clairvoyant visionary gift. So in fact, he had this kind of effective partnership with Annie Besant, who did not have this particular gift. So the two were combining together their own talents. Annie Besant was the charismatic leader. Charles Webster Leadbeater, in fact, had these kind of clairvoyant gifts. And in some of their publications, they published also several books together. Well, you can see that they were trying to render their ideas, but also their experiences with the spiritual world in a direct visual form. And in fact, you have an example here with a book on the chakras. This is a striking image. So it's a form, it's a sort of mandala in a way. And this is a book that was published in 1927, in this case by Leadbeater alone. And here, on the other hand, you have the Dutch translation of an earlier book, a very important book. So this is the Zichtbare and Onzichtbare Mensch, Dutch translation of Man Visible and Invisible. The Dutch translation is from 1903, and it was actually very early because the English original edition was published only slightly earlier. And in fact, it's interesting to see, well, let me see whether I can find an interesting picture from this book. So you can see here an image of the human figure surrounded by the aura, because Leadbeater claimed that he had this power, this gift of seeing this kind of subtle element made of light that is supposed to be around the human being, and whose color tells us something about the state of mind or the emotional state of the person. So what is interesting is that these publications and others, another famous one is Thought Forms, were read by artists, and some artists found them particularly interesting and were inspired by them also in creating their works of art. So, for instance, the influence of these publications on the development of early abstract art has been studied by several scholars and has been considered as particularly important. And here we have a very important book by a Dutch scholar, Marty Bax, Het Web der Schepping, The Web of Creation, which is a study of the early developments of abstract art in the Netherlands, particularly by Mondrian and the other artists that were part of his own circle. Mondrian was actually actively involved in Theosophy. He was even the secretary of the Amsterdam Lodge of the Theosophical Society for a while. And here we have an important catalogue of an exhibition that was held in Los Angeles and also in The Hague in 1986, called The Spiritual in Art, Abstract Painting, 1890-1985. This is the first edition of this catalog, which is still in print, by the way. It has been reprinted ever since, with an with the frontispiece facing an illustration taken in fact from Thought Forms from 1905. And this catalog is full of beautiful images and very interesting essays, which really study, among other things, the influence of theosophical thought on artists at the turn of the 20th century. And the last thing I would like to mention briefly is the case of probably the most famous painter theosophist, so not just influenced by theosophy, but really fully involved in theosophy and even creating his own brand of theosophy. And this is Nicolas Roerich, who together with his wife Helena Roerich created his own version of theosophy, which he called Agni Yoga. And this is a very nice book published by Ruth A. Dreyer in 2005. Which is a kind of biography of Roerich and his wife. So it's clear that this tells us a lot about the broad cultural impact that theosophy had on society and culture at the time. And now I would like to mention a few highlights from the collection of the Bibliotheca Philosophica Hermetica. It is interesting to know that there is a very nice collection of papers by a very prominent member of the early Theosophical Society here at the library, and this is Isabel Cooper Oakley. Isabel Cooper Oakley was a friend of Madame Blavatsky and was a very interesting figure. She has practically been ignored by historians so far, so she has not been studied so much. But she was really an important figure because she spent a long time in Italy, and in fact she was instrumental in setting up the Italian branch of the Theosophical Society in Italy. So she was a very influential figure in the history of the Theosophical Movement in Italy. And there is a whole collection of her papers here at the library. And in fact, most of these papers relate to some of the books that she wrote, which have to do with the tradition of secret societies, and also she wrote a book about the Comte de Saint-Germain, so the supposedly immortal mysterious figure that appeared sometimes in the eve of the French Revolution, and that, of course, well, is supposed to be still alive, if we believe that he is immortal. Here we have one of the books that Isabel Cooper Oakley published in the first edition, which is called Traces of a Hidden Tradition in Masonry and Medieval Mysticism, published in London in 1900 by the Theosophical Publishing Society. And as I said, most of the papers that you have in this collection here are related to these publications, but there are also some interesting examples of essays that she wrote about the contemporary history of esoteric organizations. So she writes a piece about the New Thought. So here is a manuscript about this, where she writes about Mary Baker Eddy and other related organizations. And interestingly enough, you have also something related to the history of the Theosophical Movement in Italy. So for instance, here we have a corso di studio per corrispondenza sulla dottrina segreta. So a correspondence course on the secret doctrine. So it's all in Italian, and obviously it was intended to offer some kind of introduction to the study of the secret doctrine to Italian members of the Theosophical Society. And also something else that I would like to mention that is present here in the library is a very nice collection of a rare publication, a periodical, It was extremely important. It was certainly the most important periodical in the landscape of Italian esotericism in the first half of the 20th century. And this is called Ultra. Ultra was, in fact, created in 1907 by Decio Calvari, who had been the secretary of the Italian branch of the Theosophical Society. Then later, Calvari created a split organization of his own, still calling itself Theosophical. It was a kind of independent Theosophical league. But Ultra remained perhaps a kind of periodical of reference to all those who were interested in Theosophy and more generally in esotericism. And it was certainly the longest running periodical of this kind in Italy, because, as I said, it began publications in 1907, and it went up to it continued its publications until 1930. And in fact, the date when it stopped, it's not a coincidence, because this came right after the famous Lateran Treaty between the fascist regime and the State of the Vatican with the Pope. So, which in fact prompted a politics from the fascist regime in Italy at the time more favorable to the Catholic Church, so also giving less space to all kind of heterodox or spiritualist movements then present in Italy. And we have here at the library practically an almost complete collection of the periodical running from 1907, as I said, to 1930. And I think we are now approaching to the conclusion of this webinar. Before I say goodbye, I would like to mention a few relevant publications, scholarly publications in fact, because Theosophy has become recently a subject that is attracting more and more the attention of scholars. Probably the single most important publication that has appeared very recently in fact is the Handbook of the Theosophical Current, which is edited by Olaf Hammer and Michael Rothstein, and this is part of the series called Brill Handbooks on Contemporary Religion, so published by Brill Publishers, and this was published just last year, 2013. And this is a collection of essays that in fact cover a very broad spectrum of the history of the Theosophical movement, focusing then not just on the main bodies, the main branches, but also on some minor, smaller branches, and also focusing on some of the aspects which I mentioned, and also others, for instance, the influence on the arts, political aspects, the problem of racism, which unfortunately I didn't have the time to mention. So, I mean, it's certainly the most important publication that has appeared in the last few years. Then we have two books that have been published generally about the history of the early Theosophical movement. So one is by Isaac Lubelski, Celestial India, Madame Blavatsky and the Birth of Indian Nationalism, published by Equinox, 2012. So Lubelski is an Israeli scholar, a very interesting book, especially focusing then on some political aspects. And then by Geoffrey de Lavoie, The Theosophical Society, The History of a Spiritual Movement, published by Bron Walker Press, and this also from 2012. So you see in a matter of a couple of years how many interesting things have appeared. And this is putting forward the thesis that in fact the links between the early Theosophical Society and spiritualism, the spiritualist movement, were stronger than people have so far thought. And this has actually already provoked a kind of debate also among scholars, some who agree and some who disagree with this kind of strong thesis. Another very interesting phenomenon, development recently in scholarship devoted to Theosophy, is also the focus on some local aspects in the history of Theosophy. For instance, we have here a very interesting book by Jenny McFarlane concerning the spiritual, the influence of Theosophical Society on Australian artists, 1890-1934, also from 2012, published by Australian Scholarly. So this is really focusing not just on the influence on the arts, but especially on Australia. And here, also another author interested in art, but specifically in Canadian circles, it's by Gillian McCann, Vanguard of the New Age, the Toronto Theosophical Society, 1891-1945. And this has been published by McGill's Queen's University Press, also in 2012. So in 2012 there has been a flurry of publications related to Theosophy. And then I would also mention this book, which focuses on the history of the Theosophical Society in Holland. And I think it is nice to mention it because we are at this moment located, of course, in Amsterdam and in Holland. So this is by Ruud Janssen, Een kern van broederschap, 100 years of the Theosophical Society in the Netherlands, 1897-1997. This is in Dutch and it's published by the Uitgeverij der Theosophische Vereniging in Nederland in 1997. So it's a bit of an older book. But it's full of pictures, images that are also very interesting about the history of the Theosophical Society in the Netherlands. And finally, the last thing I would like to mention is the existence of a very important journal, which focuses on the history of the Theosophical movement, really understood in a broad sense, so also with all related organizations and groups. And this is a journal called Theosophical History, published by founded by Leslie Price in 1985, so a long time ago already. So and it's still continuing publications today. Now it is edited by James Santucci, who's based in California, and this is in fact the latest issue. So no less than 16 volumes have been published. And it's a quarterly journal now. So, and this is the latest issue from October 2012. And the next issue, I am sure, will be published soon. One last thing that I am going to mention now, because I was almost forgetting, and this is the recent creation of an organization for the study of Theosophical archives. And this is very important, of course, for those who want to study the history of the Theosophical movement from a scholarly perspective. And this is called FOTA, the Friends of Theosophical Archives, and I have here a printout from their first newsletter, which has been circulated as a PDF, so not in a printed form. And this is very, very recent because it's dated March 2014, so it has just been issued, and this is the first issue, in fact. So this is a group of persons interested in the history of the Theosophical movement who are trying to work also for the preservation of the material history of Theosophy, so archives, libraries, and so on. Having said which, I think we have come full circle in the overview that I wanted to give of the Theosophical movement. Of course, I could have said many more things, because in fact the history of the Theosophical movement is much more complex and broader than I was able to mention. But I hope that at least this gave you an idea of how many interesting things there are to say and to study about this movement. Thank you very much, and I hope to see you again for the next webinar.